Good morning, students. Welcome back to your English Literature online class. In today's class, I will be teaching you yet another story from this storybook, that is Animal Stories by Ruskin Bolt. And the name of the story is A Crow in the House. So let's start. A young crow had fallen from its nest and was fluttering about on the road. As it was in danger of being crushed by a cart or a tonga or seized by a cat, I brought it home. So basically the narrator is saying that long ago there was a young crow who had fallen from its nest and the crow was badly injured. And so the crow was alive, but the crow was injured and the crow wanted to fly away. The crow was flapping his wings, and that flapping of wings made a fluttering sound. So now the narrator noticed that the crow was lying on the road injured, and narrator thought that the crow might get hurt by a cart. Now cart is a vehicle with two or four wheels that is basically pulled by a horse. So the narrator was worried that the crow might get hurt or might get crushed by a cart or a tonga, or might get attacked by a cat. So the narrator brought that injured young crow to his house. It was in a sorry condition, beak gaping and head drooping, and we did not expect it to live. But my grandfather and I did our best to bring it around. Now, the narrator is saying that when he brought that injured crow to his house, he noticed that his beak, the beak of the crow, was wounded and his head was bent. So, the narrator says that he and his grandfather did not expect that the crow would live. They thought that the crow would die. But they both did their best to bring it, to make it, to keep the crow alive. So how did they try to cure the injured crow? We fed it by gently pressing its beak open with a pencil and pushing in a little bread and milk, then removing the pencil to allow it to swallow. We varied this diet with occasional doses of my grandmother's homemade plum wine. As a result, the young crow was soon on its way to recovery. Now, what the narrator and the grandfather did, they both opened the crow's beak with a pencil. So they opened it gently with a pencil, and then they pushed a little bread and milk. Inside the beak. And then they removed the pencil and allowed the crow to swallow it. Now, they also the narrator's grandmother used to make a homemade plum wine. And the narrator and the grandfather also used to feed this homemade plum wine to the crow. And as a result, what happened? The crow started to feel better. The crow started to recover. He was offered freedom, but instead he made himself at home in our house. Now, the narrator says that after the crow was recovered, after the injured crow had recovered, the narrator and the grandfather tried to free the crow. But the crow insisted on staying at the narrator's house. He did not fly away then again. He just remained at the narrator's house. My grandfather, Aunt Mabel, and even some of grandfather's pets objected, but there was no way of getting rid of the bird. Now, the narrator says that the grandfather, and there was one aunt also, narrator's aunt, whose name was Aunt Mabel, and even some of the grandfather's pets. Now, I told you that the narrator, we have already read so many stories, and we know that the narrator had a lot of pets. So the narrator says that some of the grandfather's pets and my pets and the grandmother and Aunt Mabel did not wanted the crow to be at home. But there was no way to get rid of the bird. The crow just wanted to stay with the narrator at his house. The bird did not want it to go away. He soon took over the administration of the house. We were not sure he was male, but we called him Caesar. Now, soon the crow started to get comfortable in the house, and the narrator says that the narrator did not know whether the crow was a male or a female, but they named the crow Caesar. Okay, so the narrator kept the crow also as a pet, and the narrator named the crow Caesar. Before long, Caesar was joining us at meal times. Besides finding his own grub or beetles in the garden. Now, grub or beetles are insects. He danced about on the dining table and gave us no peace till he had been given his small bowl of meat, soup and vegetables. Now, the narrator says that whenever they used to, a narrator and the grandfather and their family used to sit on the dining table to have their meals, then this crow, this young crow, would find his own insects and eat with them in the dining room. And the crow did not let the narrator and his family eat until and unless he himself, the crow himself, was offered small bowl of meat, soup and some vegetables. He was always restless, fidgeting about investigating things. Now this crow was always restless. Restless means the crow never used to relax. He would always move here and there and investigate about things. Investigate means find out about different types of things. Whatever he used to find at home, he used to start investigating about it. He would hop about a table to empty a matchbox of its contents, or rip the daily paper to shreds, overturn a vase of flowers, or tug at the tail of one of the dogs. So what all mischief did the crow did? The crow used to empty the matchbox. The crow used to take out all the matchsticks out of the matchbox. And the crow used to rip, used to tear the newspaper that was that used to come into the narrator's house. And also the crow used to overturn, throw away a vase of flowers, and sometimes used to pull the tail of one of the narrator's dog. So these are all the naughty things that the crow used to do at the narrator's home. "That crow will be the ruin of us," grumbled my grandmother, picking marigolds off the carpet. "Can't you keep him in a cage?" Now, after seeing so many naughty things done by the crow, the grandmother used to get very angry. So one day the grandmother says that this crow will destroy everything in our house. And while saying so, she was picking the marigold. Now, marigold, you know, it's a flower. So the grandmother was picking the marigold from off the carpet. And why was she picking, why was the marigold on the carpet? Because the crow, this Caesar, had overturned, had thrown away a vase full of marigold flowers. So the grandmother got very angry, and she insisted, and she says that to the narrator to keep this crow in a cage. "We did try putting Caesar in a cage, but he became so angry and objected with such fierce cawing and flapping that it was better for our nerves and peace of mind to give him the run of the house." Now the narrator says that he tried to put Caesar, the crow, in a cage. But what happened? Whenever they used to put Caesar in a cage, Caesar would get very angry. And he used to continuously make noises and would flap his wings. So the narrator says that it is better for their own peace to keep the crow out of the cage instead of putting it inside the cage. "He did not show any inclination to join the other crows in the banyan tree." Now you all know that the narrator also had a banyan tree, right? So the narrator says that this crow, Caesar, did not show any interest to go outside the house and join the other crows that were there on the banyan tree. Grandfather said this was because he was really a jungle crow, a raven of sorts, and probably felt contemptuous towards ordinary carrion crows. But it seemed to me that Caesar, having grown used to living with humans on equal terms, had become snobbish and did not wish to mix with his own kind. Now, the grandfather says that Caesar didn't want to go to the banyan tree and join the other crows on the banyan tree because this particular crow that they brought home, Caesar, was a jungle crow. It was a wild crow. And the grandfather also says that he hated this crow, was a jungle crow, and he hated other crows that were the normal carrion crows. So that is why this Caesar never went to join the other crows that were there on the banyan tree. But on the other hand, the narrator says that what he felt is that living with humans, since Caesar had lived a long time with the narrator and his family, so the narrator says that living with humans on equal terms, Caesar had become snobbish. Snobbish means full of attitude, very proudy. Caesar had become very, very proudy, and that is why he did not want to mix with its own kind. He would even squabble with Harold the Hornbill. Now the narrator says, do you remember Harold the Hornbill? We studied about this pet in the first chapter of this storybook. So the narrator says that he would even, the crow, the jungle crow, that is Caesar, would even quarrel with Harold. What he used to do? He used to, perching on top of Harold's cage, he would peck at the big bird's feet. So Caesar would reach at the top of the cage where Harold the Hornbill was kept, and he used to peck at this big bird's feet. Whereupon Harold would swear and scold and try to catch Caesar through the bars, and Harold would try to catch Caesar through the bars of his cage. In time, Caesar learned to talk a little, as ravens sometimes do, in a cracked, throaty voice. Now, y'all know, ravens have this ability to talk. Okay, they can learn to talk. So, the narrator also says that since Caesar, I told you Caesar was a raven, Caesar was a jungle crow. So, the narrator says that Caesar also, with time, started to talk. The Caesar learned to talk, and he used to talk in a very throaty voice, in a very itchy voice. He would sit for hours outside the window, banging on the glass with his beak and calling hello, hello. So what he used to do? Caesar used to sit on the window and he used to say hello, hello. Okay. He seemed to recognize the click of the gate when I came home from school and would come to the door with a hop, skip and a jump to say hello, hello. Narrator says that whenever he used to come home from school, and by the click of the gate, the crow, the Caesar used to know that the narrator had come home, and he used to greet the narrator with hello, hello in his cracked and throaty voice. I also taught him to sit on my arm and say kiss, kiss while he placed his head gently against my mouth. Now, narrator says that I also taught Caesar to say kiss, kiss. He used to place Caesar gently on his arm, and he taught him how to say kiss, kiss. And Caesar used to say kiss, kiss, and he used to place his beak gently against the narrator's mouth. On one of Aunt Mabel's visits, he alighted on her arm and cackled kiss, kiss. Now, one day what happened? I told you about Aunt Mabel. So, Aunt Mabel visited the narrator's house, the narrator. And what happened? The crow, this jungle crow, Caesar, went and sat on her arm. And then he said, the crow said, kiss, kiss. So, Aunt Mabel became very happy. and probably fluttered and leaned forward for a kiss. So Aunt Mabel, when the crow said kiss, kiss, Aunt Mabel became very happy and Aunt Mabel leaned forward to kiss the crow. But Caesar's attention had shifted to Aunt's gleaming spectacles. Now the aunt was wearing spectacles, glasses, and they were very shiny. So instead of kissing, the crow noticed these shiny spectacles and he pushed them with his beak and knocked them off. Aunt Mabel was never success with pets. So instead of kissing Aunt Mabel, what did the crow do? The crow pushed away the shiny glasses that the aunt was wearing and knocked them off. Pet or pest was a subject of dispute in the household. Now pest, what is the meaning of pest? Pest means an animal or a person that annoys and destroys everything in the house. Okay. So the narrator says that pet or pest was a big subject of argument in the house. Grandmother insisted that Caesar was the latter in spite of his engaging habits. And grandmother always said that Caesar was not a pet but a pest, an animal who used to annoy everybody. Okay. If he had restricted his activities to our own house, it would not have been so bad. But he took to visiting neighbors' houses and stealing pens and pencils, hair ribbons, combs, keys, shuttlecocks, toothbrushes and false teeth. Now the narrator said that if the crow only did mischief in the house, then it would have been okay. But the crow also did naughty things with other people that used to live near the narrator's house. What he used to do? The crow used to visit the neighbors' houses and steal. Steal means chori karna. And used to steal pens, pencils, hair ribbons, toothbrushes, shuttlecocks, false teeth and everything and all sorts of other things from the neighbors. He was especially fond of toothbrushes and made a collection of them on top of the cupboard in my room. Narrator says that this crow, Caesar, was fond of toothbrushes. So he used to go to the neighbors' houses, steal their toothbrushes and keep a collection of all these toothbrushes at the top of the narrator's cupboard. Most of the neighbors were represented in our house by a toothbrush. Toothbrush sales went up that year and so did grandmother's blood pressure. Now as toothbrushes were coming into the house, as the Caesar was stealing toothbrushes from their neighbors, so as the amount of toothbrushes increased, at the same time the amount of anger of grandmother's increased. Caesar spied on children going to the Banta's shop and often managed to snatch sweets from them as they came out. Now you can imagine how naughty Caesar was. Caesar used to spy. Spy means jasusi karna. Caesar used to spy on the children that went to the Banta's shop. There was a shop, Banta's shop, where the children used to buy sweets for them. So Caesar would spy those children, and then when the children would return home with their sweets in hand, Caesar would go and snatch, take away the sweets from their hands. Clothes pegs fascinated him. Now what are clothes pegs? Clothes pegs is a wooden or a plastic clip that we used for securing clothes to a clothesline. Okay. So these clothes pegs also fascinated Caesar. Caesar loved clothes pegs, these clips that we use to tie clothes on a clothesline. So neighbors would return from the bazaar to find their washing lying in the mud and no signs of their pegs. So what this crow used to do? Caesar used to go to the narrator's house, go to the neighbors' houses, and there used to be a cloth line with clothes attached with clips, these pegs. So this crow Caesar would go and take away all the pegs from the clothes and used to keep a collection of this also at the top of the cupboard of the narrator's, at the top of the narrator's cupboard. So whenever the neighbors used to go to bazaar and they used to return to their house, they would notice that all these clothes were all lying on the mud and the pegs, the clips were missing. It was Caesar's gardening activities which finally led to disaster. He was helping himself to a neighbor's beans when a stick was flung at him, breaking his leg. So one day what happened? An accident took place. Because of all these activities, one day a stick was flung at Caesar, and that stick attacked Caesar, and his the leg of the crow broke because of that stick. Okay, so when Caesar broke his leg, what did the narrator do? I carried the unfortunate bird home, and grandfather and I washed and bandaged his leg as best as we could, but it would not mend. So when the narrator noticed that Caesar had broken his leg, so the narrator brought again the crow to his house and then washed him and bandaged his leg, but his leg would not mend. It was broken and it would not mend. Caesar hung his head and no longer talked. Caesar bent his head and refused to talk. He grew very weak. He grew weaker every day by day, refusing to eat. So Caesar even did not eat. Caesar hung his head and no longer talked. Then he also grew weaker and he did not eat. An occasional sip of grandmother's homemade wine was all that kept him going. But the narrator and the grandfather used to feed him the homemade plum wine that was made by the grandmother. And that was the only thing that was keeping the crow, that is Caesar, alive. One morning, I found him dead on the sofa, his legs stiff in the air. So the narrator says that one day he noticed that the crow was dead. Caesar was dead on the sofa and his legs were stiff in the air. Poor Caesar, his antisocial habits has led to his early end. Now narrator says, so because of his, because of the naughty things that he did, he is now no more. I dug a shallow grave in the garden and buried him there along with all the toothbrushes and clothes pens he had taken the trouble to collect. Now the narrator says that when Caesar was dead, the narrator dug a grave in the garden, in his garden, and buried Caesar in that grave along with all the toothbrushes and cloth pegs that he had taken from their neighbor. I told you that Caesar used to keep a collection of toothbrushes and cloth pegs. So narrator dug a grave, buried Caesar in that grave along with the toothbrushes and the cloth pegs. Okay, so children, I hope this story is clear to you. Your half yearly course is now completed. I will provide you the PDF exercises of this lesson very soon. Okay, thank you.